The big show begins on Wednesday. Public hearings in the run-up to a House vote on impeachment. On one level, it is a television show. On another level, it is a test for democracy and a test for the American press. So let me start with three things that we know right now and three things we don't. First, we know that we should tune in for the hearings and tune out the spin. Some people are going to insult your intelligence in the days ahead. They're going to say the Ukraine scandal is too complicated, that there's too many players. In fact, some of them are already saying that.
It's not a sexy scandal. This is about a transcript of a phone call with a country no one cares about. No one can find Ukraine on a map.
Come on, man. If you don't think your viewers can find Ukraine on a map, then pull up a map. Help them find it. That's the next thing we know. The onus is on reporters, not pundits like Jesse Waters, but reporters to help readers and viewers navigate through this story. Media shapes the public's understanding of issues, for better and for worse. And these days, the word media encompasses everything from CNN to your uncle's Facebook feed to your kid's TikTok account. So it is incumbent to seek out high-quality sources of information as this impeachment effort unfolds. Look, some people are going to tell you that it's a bust no matter what. They're already cooking up talking points for after these hearings. But don't buy into the predictable, pre-baked narratives. Decide for yourself. And third, the third thing we know, through all of this, Trump is going to keep repeating, frankly, some pretty dumb lies, like his claim that he has 95% support among Republicans. He keeps saying this over and over again. He said it again yesterday. The message, of course, is that everyone's standing by him, that no Republican dare defect. But in reality, Trump's approval rating among Republicans is not 95%. Look for yourself. It's anywhere from 74% to 90%, depending on the recent poll. I bring this up because some of the distortions really do matter. And ultimately, this impeachment process is about trust and abuse of power. Through sheer force, Trump is going to try to convince you that this is just about a single phone call. And his Fox friends are going to help him try. So journalists will have to keep cutting through the fog and fight for a well-informed public. When he says it's all about a phone call, fact-checkers have to say it's about a months-long attempt to pressure a foreign leader to help Trump win re-election. And we already know all of this. The details are right there in the transcripts and depositions. But here are three things we don't know. Number one, just how low will the deception go? How deep will the deceit go? Trump's defense is predicated on cheap slogans like coup and hoax. He's constantly contradicting himself, saying those slogans over and over again. You know, one minute he says, read the transcript of his call. The next minute he says that Adam Schiff is going to doctor the deposition transcripts. He says the process should be public, but then he objects to televised hearings. So this is going to go on and on. How deep will the deception go? And the number two thing we don't know is, from a TV standpoint, will people tune in? Will people really tune in? I mean, in TV terms, and I sometimes hate to talk this way, but let's be honest. This is, at least on one level, a television show that's about to unfold. Will the Democrats put on a powerful first episode? Will they convince people to keep watching? Well, I noticed this in CNN's Lauren Fox's story this weekend, a Democratic House leadership aide telling Lauren, the first hour of the hearing and the first hearing has got to be a blockbuster. I mean, that's true. From a political standpoint, the first episode matters a lot, in the same way that in Hollywood, the first episode of a show either hooks you or doesn't. So will the Dems deliver? That's an unknown. And number three, most importantly, forget the TV part. From a democracy standpoint, will Americans care? Will any of this matter? Sometimes it seems like nothing matters anymore in the Trump age. Don't buy that. It matters if we all believe it does. So here to discuss is someone really special. Bill Moyers was the White House press secretary during the Lyndon Johnson years. Then, of course, headed to NBC and PBS and other major networks. You probably know him from his many years as a longtime host on PBS. And he's here with me in New York for a special one-on-one interview. Bill, thanks for joining me.
My pleasure.
I've been around a little longer than me. You covered Watergate. You covered the Clinton impeachment. On the eve of another impeachment inquiry, hearings this week, do you fear for the country?
For the first time in my long life, and I was born in the Depression, lived through World War II, have been a part of politics and government for all these years now. Yes, for the first time, because a society, a democracy can die of too many lies. And we're getting close to that terminal moment unless we reverse the obsession with lies that are being fed around the country.
So will people care this week? Will democracy hold up through this process?
Some people will always care. And we have to remember that we need to serve those people who will get up in the morning and watch the hearings, will come home at night and watch the hearings, because they really want to be confused. They want to understand, they want to cut through the confusion, the lies. So we have to be concerned with them. Then we have to think about, how do we reach the people who don't care? Do facts matter anymore? I think they do. I think they mattered in the Watergate hearings, in the Clinton hearings, and I think they'll matter this time too. I listened this morning to Donald Trump's rally in Louisiana. It was astonishing. He shouted at his audience and they responded. They believed everything he said. I'm hoping only 10% of those people come and watch the hearings in toto. Mm-hmm. They will see it's not a witch hunt, and they will begin to doubt their master, and they will begin to break off and maybe become a citizen again instead of a partisan.
Mm. So when he says coup and hoax, even if many of his supporters believe that, it just takes 10%, perhaps, you're saying.
Yeah, I think in a close election, and as you know, he's strong in many states, even though he's not popular. Mm. And I think his chances of winning, like most people do, are pretty good. Mm. We have to keep that in mind. It may be only a slight shift in the swing states, but of people who begin to doubt the lies and begin to live by something else.
You know, you've issued a challenge to PBS, your former longtime home, saying that PBS should rebroadcast the hearings in prime time. That, you know, for folks who are out and about at work or at school at noon or 1 p.m., they should be able to watch in prime time. How important is this? Why did you decide to issue this challenge?
Well, these are my friends and colleagues for many years, as you say, and I'm so old, I can look back and see how the trends have changed. They don't remember the Watergate hearings, but I remember in 1973, when PBS was under fierce attack from Richard Nixon and his cronies like Pat Buchanan, who called for defunding it and getting rid of it, PBS did a very brave thing. They broadcast the hearings not only during the day, but at night, so that people who are working and can't watch it during the day can come home if they want to, if they're part of that 10% who really care, and watch the whole drama unfold. Mm. Brian, right next to where I live, 7 or 8 construction workers are putting a new roof on the church next door to us. They work hard all day. They're very expert in what they do. It's a hard and dangerous job. When they go home at night, if only one of those 7 or 8 want to watch the hearings as they occur during the day, it's very hard to find them. PBS is going to put them on a small digital sub.
Yeah, what's it called? The World
the
Channel.
World.
I have to be honest, I'd never heard of it before.
Here in New York,
it's a sub channel where they're going to show the hearings at night, but. You're saying that's no replacement for showing them on the main channel.
The World has some fine programs on it. But here in New York, as you just indicated, the channel is channel 1728, I think. Very hard to find. And World across the country reaches only half of the public television stations. That workman, if he's a citizen as well as a contractor, if he wants to see it and make up his own mind about what he's seeing, there's very little chance, except on C-SPAN, for him to do that. So I think even though the universe of our business has changed in these last 40-something years, that PBS has a public service obligation, almost a duty, to care for people who can't be at home and watch it during the day.
It also makes me think about the responsibility that other broadcasters, other networks, other newsrooms have at this moment in time to try to help people be as well-informed as possible. You wrote in your column recently that episodic coverage of the news is not enough. And I wonder if you could expand on what you mean.
Well, my colleague, longtime colleague, we met during the Watergate hearings, Michael Winship, and I wrote two columns on commondreams.org now and at billmoyers.com. We said our job as journalists is to slice and dice the events of the day as they occur or the day after usually, but you don't get the whole story there. If you want to get the whole story with the frame of the narrative of Watergate, you needed to watch the whole hearings. If you want to get the whole story of Trumpgate, you need to watch the whole hearing. So not just the episodes that occur every day, which you and others will handle in a professional way, but connecting the dots, telling the story, putting the whole picture up there. It's a puzzle. This is a complex puzzle. But it's also a momentous moment in America's life. Only two presidents have ever been impeached. The third, Richard Nixon, would have been impeached had he not resigned. This is a moment in American history where the arc of justice will either be bent forward or it'll be bent backward. So everyone who wants to see it should have the chance to see the whole story. You don't go, you know, it's like watching a football game and on the bottom of the screen, they put up the scores of other games. Well, you know who's ahead and who's behind, but you don't know how the game is being played. If you watch these hearings coming up, and you should have a chance to watch them in prime time, and don't just leave it to the pundits and analysts, that's good as far as it goes, you will see the game being played, the game of politics at its most dangerous and, as I said, momentum point.